planning board for tonight. This open meeting of the planning board is being conducted remotely pursuant to Chapter 2, the Acts of 2023, an act relative to extending certain COVID-19 measures adopted during the state of emergency, signed into law March 29, 2023. All members of the planning board are allowed and encouraged to participate remotely. The act allows the planning board to meet entirely remotely so long as reasonable public access is afforded so that the public can follow along with the deliberations of the meeting. The public is encouraged to follow along using the posted agenda unless the chair notes otherwise. Members of the public who wish to view the live stream of this meeting may do so by going to Northborough Remote Meetings on YouTube via the link listed on the agenda. Ensuring public access does not ensure public participation unless participation is required by law. This meeting will not feature public comment tonight. We have no hearing, so I'm assuming. Lori, do we have to open up for a public comment for an A&R?
Well, we do have Scott Charpentier here to speak on the A&R in case there are any questions.
Okay, well, I'll leave it open to public comment if we decide to go that way. Members, when I call your name, please respond in the affirmative. Bill Pierce?
Here.
Millie Milton?
Here.
Anthony Zeitin?
Here.
And I'm here. And also staff, Lori Connors?
I'm here.
And I don't see Scott just yet.
He is in the attendees.
Okay.
And he's got his hand raised.
Meeting ground rules, we all know. The chair will invite each speaker or applicant on the agenda to name by name to make a presentation or speak to their application. Each speaker will be asked to mute their phone or computer when not speaking, to speak clearly in a way that helps generate accurate meeting minutes. Those responding will be asked to wait until the floor is yielded to them by the chair. Speakers who wish to respond to the comments of others do so through the chair, taking care to identify themselves. Each vote taken by the board or committee will be conducted by roll call vote. It is now 6:06. First on our agenda will be the A&R for 13 Church Street. We're going to take this agenda a little bit out of order so Scott doesn't have to stay for our whole meeting.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
And Millie.
Millie, you'll have to recuse yourself.
Do I go out or do I just silence or what do I do?
If you could just make a statement that you're recusing yourself, and then I believe you have to turn your camera off.
Okay. I am recusing myself from this discussion.
Just don't go far. All right, Scott, take it away.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As you see, the A&R plan was submitted. I'm a little late. I appreciate you accepting it and pushing me up on the agenda. It's 13 Church Street, the old fire station. The town is preparing an RFP to put out on the street for disposition of the real property. As part of that process, an A&R plan was developed for a rear lot line amendment, which has been incorporated on the drawing you have before you. And I'm hoping the planning board can act on this evening.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions? This includes what? A new lot line you said and two easements, one from WCD and one from 13 Church Street?
Sort of. The rear lot line has been amended. The easement A in the back is an easement WCD garage is granting to the town of Northborough for the presence of a pump station. Easement B is not an easement that's enacted until the 13 Church Street parcel transfers ownership from the town of Northborough to a new owner. Currently, it's owned by the town. The town can't grant an easement to the town. But the purview of the planning board this evening is the A&R lot, which is the rear property line. The easements are sort of a separate topic. But again, one is for the pump station. There is an agreement in place with WCD garage owner, 44 West Main Street, with the town. And then easement B will be conveyed when and if a new owner arises at 13 Church Street.
Okay. So it's drawing in this lot line?
Yep.
Okay. Does anybody on? Oh, there's Lori. You got a question? Sure.
So both Fred Litchfield and I have reviewed the A&R. And we do have a waiver request letter. So the first waiver is, of course, a request to waive the application fee of $250. And the second waiver request is to waive the requirement to show the zoning classification of all areas on the plan, including groundwater district and uplands area. So I'm hoping that you folks will vote those two waivers before you vote on the plan.
Why don't you guys want to show the groundwater on the plan? I'm just curious.
It's not part of a development. It's an A&R line, has no impact on impervious areas, construction. My expectation is in the event this parcel is developed, that plan that comes before the planning board would include all overlay districts, including the underlying districts. But where this is a simple lot line change, it has no bearing on use, structures, construction, or districts.
I thought, Lori, we didn't have to. I thought with the A&R, you just have to show that it has proper frontage and lot size.
It's a requirement in our subdivision regs that the zoning classification be shown on the plan. So because it's not on this plan, they are requesting a waiver.
Okay. Does anyone on the board have any concerns with either waiver?
No.
Okay, I'm gonna stop sharing because I can't see people when I share. Okay. All right, does anyone have any questions before we make a motion? All right. Lori, I was gonna make a motion to approve the A&R for 13 Church Street with the two waivers requested, the waive the application fee of $250 and the waiver that they don't have to include the zoning classification.
If you could do me a favor and separate the votes. So the first vote would be a waiver of the filing fee in the amount of $250.
Do I hear a second? Or so moved.
So moved.
And Anthony, you second?
Second.
Okay, roll call vote. Bill Pierce.
Aye.
Anthony Zeitin.
Aye.
And Amy Pritzky's an aye. That passes.
The second waiver is from the requirement to show the zoning classifications of the property.
We just so moved that?
Yep. Second.
Okay. Roll call vote. Anthony Zeitin.
Aye.
Bill Pierce.
Aye.
And Amy Pritzky's an aye. That waiver passes.
And then the third motion would be to endorse the plan entitled A&R and Easement Plan 13 Church Street, Northborough, Mass. Prepared by Chappelle Engineering Associates, LLC. Dated July 1st, 2022.
So moved.
Seconded.
Okay, roll call vote. Bill Pierce?
Aye.
Anthony Zeitin?
Aye.
Amy Peritsky's an aye, and the A&R passes. All right.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, board members.
Have a good night. Work.
Thank you, too.
Okay. We'll wait for Millie to come back.
I'm here. Magic.
So it's now 6:13. Second on our agenda, I'd like to ask Lori to describe the fee schedule that she prepared for us and procurement for a consulting engineer.
Sure. So as I have promised you for many months now, I have done an analysis of fees of many of our nearby communities, including the towns of Grafton, Hudson, Marlborough, Millbury, Shrewsbury, Southborough, and Westborough, so that we could look at what our neighboring communities are charging applicants for submissions and also for technical review. And then we could look at our own fees, which are shown on this on this table in red, and we could see if it would be prudent for us to adjust our fees. So one of the impetuses for this is, of course, the town engineer position, as you know, is being combined with the assistant DPW director position. And that means that we are not going to have the level of assistance of in-house engineering as we have had historically. So we are going to have to hire an outside consultant. So the typical process for hiring a consultant is that we request technical review fees from applicants up front, not necessarily from everybody, not for really small projects, but for the medium scale and larger projects, we would need those fees. So I am proposing a new fee schedule, and actually I can go through them line by line. And there are many of the fees that I'm recommending to stay the same, but then there are some new fees that have never existed in the past. And then there is also increase in certain fees. So I'd be happy to go through those with you, starting with the new fee schedule. And I will admit that part of the reason why I really wanted to do this is because the existing fee schedule is very confusing, because it doesn't seem to cover all of the applications that are before us. Like, for example, it talks about industrial special permits, but it doesn't say whether there's a fee for the other type of special permits we issue. So we've kind of been stumbling around in the dark, wondering if we're charging the correct fees or not. So the idea here is to remove all the guesswork out of the equation, identify all of the various types of permits that possibly could be issued by this board, and you know, have a fee associated with that. So if you want to start with, so I divided the fee schedule into subdivisions, site plan approval, special permit, and then other. So A&R, I'm not actually recommending to change that fee at all. Currently the fee is $250 plus $50 per new lot created. When I looked at the neighboring communities, that fee didn't really seem to be out of whack from what many of the communities around us are charging. So I thought it would be good to just leave that the same. And the same is true for the next fee, preliminary plan. That fee would be $500 plus $50 per building lot, same as what it currently is. However, I am recommending submission of a technical review fee of $2,500. Obviously, engineers aren't cheap, and so the fee has to be pretty hefty. It is hard to come up with, because, of course, we could have a preliminary plan that involves four lots, or we could have a preliminary plan that involves 100 lots. So typically what happens when you have an engineering consultant is they prepare a cost estimate upfront. And if it seems like the $2,500 isn't going to be sufficient, then what I would do is I go back to the applicant and say, hey, you know, here is the cost estimate from our consulting engineer. $2,500 isn't going to be adequate. I'm going to need whatever X number of dollars is specified in their estimate. So next item is definitive plan Seguin case. So that's kind of a hybrid. I'm not sure if you folks have had a Seguin in the recent past. Essentially, that's a circumstance where they want to create a new lot, but the new lot does not meet the minimum frontage requirement. So it's a two-step process. they would have to go to the ZBA first, see if they could get a frontage variance from the ZBA. And then if they were successful in getting the frontage variance, then they would come to the planning board. So it's similar to an A&R, but it technically doesn't qualify as an A&R. So that is why I'm recommending that the filing fee be identical as it is for an A&R. I've only had a handful of Seguin cases in my career, but they do come up now and again. So I would like to have a fee that covers them. They are a public hearing. So I would like to request an advertising fee. So historically, advertising has been covered by our operating budget. So that means the taxpayers are paying to advertise for everybody's applications anytime a public hearing is called. But that's very unusual. Most communities require the applicant to pay the advertising fee. So we have looked at, of course, we have moved to the community advocate. We used to advertise with the Worcester TNG, but a few months ago, we made the move to the advocate, support our local paper. The advertising fee for 2 weeks tends to hover around $350. Sometimes it's less than that, sometimes it's more than that. So that's why I am requesting an advertising fee of $350. Does anybody have any questions about that? No. So definitive plan, when a preliminary plan was filed, I am recommending an increase in the fee. So currently the fee is $1,000 plus $100 per lot. That really doesn't go very far. Typically, communities like their fees to bear some sort of resemblance to the level of effort that staff goes through, at least when reviewing a plan, not necessarily when constructing it. And this updated filing fee, I think, is more appropriate given the level of work. It's still very low. Technical review fee for definitive subdivision, I'm recommending $8,000. We would require engineering expertise to review a subdivision, and then also to inspect all aspects of a subdivision. So if there were extra money left over in that $8,000 fee, then what I would recommend is that it move over towards the inspection of a project. If a project isn't approved for one reason or another, then 90 days after the decision, the money would have to be returned to the applicant. Once again, recommending a filing advertising fee of $350. The next bullet down is definitive plan when a preliminary plan was not filed. That fee was already pretty high, so I am not recommending to change that fee. So that fee is identical to the way it is today. Of course, adding technical review fee, adding advertising fee. Major modification to an approved definitive plan. I'm also not recommending that we change that fee. I thought that $250 plus $50 per lot was appropriate for a major modification. It's in line with what the other communities are charging. Next, we have performance guarantee. So of course, periodically with the subdivision, most developers put in place a covenant as a performance guarantee. And then when they put down the binder course of pavement on the roadway, they swap out the covenant and they put up alternative type of performance guarantee, which is either cash, a tripartite agreement, or a performance bond. I'm not really a big fan of performance bonds, but this would enable us to charge a fee anytime somebody asks for a release from the covenant. So there is some work associated with that. And then inevitably, you go through the effort of granting the lot release, getting the signatures from all of your board members, and then they lose the lot release. So this is a filing fee to reissue the lot release. This is identical to what is in our fee schedule today. So under site plan approval, this is kind of a hybrid. So right now the filing fee is $500 plus 5 cents per square foot of building area. And that's it. So it doesn't distinguish between commercial, industrial, residential, or projects that have no building. So it is one of those instances where it's kind of confusing what we're supposed to charge. So what I am proposing is to have a separate fee of $50 per dwelling unit for residential site plan approval. And then if there is no building, so say you're just going through site plan approval because they're doing parking modifications, so maybe they're expanding their lot. In that circumstance, they would pay the $500 plus $20 per new parking space. So because site plan approval can really vary a lot on the level of effort, and of course, I'm hoping that we will have the assistance of the assistant DPW director. Like I said, for smaller, medium projects, I don't anticipate charging a technical review fee because we'll be able to handle that in-house. But for big projects, we would need a technical review fee. But it depends on how complicated the project is, whether we're going to need, you know, a transportation engineer to consult. So I put in here to be determined at time of application. The standard fee that I used to charge when I was in Millbury was $6,500. In some cases, that fee ended up being way too much. So how do you folks feel about having it kind of loose like that? Or would you rather have it be a set number?
I'd be more comfortable with a set number than to have something loose like that and have it up to interpretation.
Okay. So do you feel comfortable with the 6,500, or do you think an alternative amount would be better?
Well, do you reimburse the amounts that aren't spent, or is it 6,500 and then we use whatever's left over for something else?
Yeah, so what happens with these technical review fee accounts is that we have to create a separate account for every single project that we collect a technical review fee. So that fee can only be used for that one project, and that's it.
Sure.
Sometimes if we have leftover money and we need the consulting engineer to do inspections, then we just use the leftover money for the inspections, and then we close out the account when the project is complete. That's actually more often than not. Okay. So the only time when we would return money at that point is either A, we're going to do the inspections in-house, so we don't need the consultant, or B, the project is denied. If the project's denied, then the money goes back.
But any leftover money, one way or another, would go back to the applicant, correct?
Correct. Oh. And then there are instances where 6,500 isn't enough.
Right, right.
And in those circumstances, like I said, we get an estimate from our consulting engineer before the project starts. And if the estimate says we're going to need 10 grand, then I would go to the applicant and say, I know that you gave us 6,500, but that's not going to cut it. I'm going to need another 3,500. Mm. And then they would have to give us 3,500 extra dollars.
And right, did you find,
Sorry, no, go ahead, Millie.
Did you find that 6,500 typically was more than enough and that you would reimburse the applicant, or was it likely not?
You know, it really, that's why I kind of said to be determined. It really was a mixed bag. Sometimes it was way too much. Other times it was, you know, it was pretty much on target. And then there were a number of times where it was way too little. So sometimes it's hard to foresee when an application is submitted, the level of effort. Like, for example, if say we have a multifamily project with 315 units, we'll use the proposed multifamily development. I would suspect that $6,500 isn't going to be near enough. Mm-hmm. So in that circumstance, I would most likely be going back to the applicant and saying, I need more. But for a smaller project, you know, maybe a project that's more in the line of 40 units, that could be plenty.
Okay.
It depends on how complicated it is. Yeah. You know, if there's a lot of, you know, super steep slopes, we're talking about retaining walls and high groundwater and, you know, if it's on Bartlett Street and we have a lot of concerns about, you know, truck traffic and the like, then it could drive the price up.
Okay.
So what should we do on this one? Do you want to ponder it and we'll get back to it?
Are we going to take a vote with the ZBA in September? Are we going to do it together to vote on these fees, or?
Yeah, so right now, this is just discussion.
Yep.
So we have to hold a public hearing. Now, the ZBA doesn't have a regulation pertaining to technical review, so they have to hold a public hearing on the regulation. Planning board already has the regulation in the planning board rules and regs. So we're good. They have far fewer fees, of course, than the planning board does, but they also have to hold a public hearing. And one of the things that I had spoken to them about last week is because you folks both issue site plan approval and you both also review special permits, I think it makes the most sense that you are on the same page with the fee. So the fee for site plan review and special permit should be the same. It'll be less confusing for applicants, I think. And then obviously, you know, technical review fee and advertising fee would also be the same. So at the ZBA meeting, they had suggested that it might make sense to have a joint public hearing. So they would be willing to come to the planning board meeting on September 5th and join your meeting if that's okay with you folks.
Sounds like a good plan to me.
Okay, so why don't we think about the tech review fee for site plan approval, and we'll come back to that.
On September 5th?
No, we'll come back to it tonight or on September 5th, whatever meets your pleasure. Right. So the next item is
quick question, sorry. So I thought in the last town meeting, didn't we agree that the zoning board was going to use the planning board's rules and regs?
Well, what we did is we modified site plan review. So now, instead of having the ZBA adopt their own site plan review regulations, they're using yours.
Okay, but it was only site plan.
Yeah, so this section, this rules and regs section, is a completely different section, so it doesn't apply.
I thought it was rules and regs too.
It just references the site plan. It was in the section of the zoning bylaw under site plan review. So it doesn't, you are not, the ZBA wasn't adopting the totality of the planning board rules and regs. Just the section regarding site plan review.
I guess I didn't get that. I thought it was the whole thing. Okay.
So major modification to site plan approval. This would be a brand new fee. Right now there is no fee. So my recommendation is $300. Under special permit, common driveway, special permit, this would be an increase. Let's see, the current fee for common driveway is $1,000 plus $100 per lot. So this is just a slight increase in the per lot fee. So instead of $100 per lot, it's $150 per lot. Under open space residential development special permit, this would be an increase, just like the definitive subdivision. It's the same fee as definitive subdivision. So it was originally the same fee as definitive subdivision, so the increase is identical. And the same is true for planned residential development special permit. Wireless communication facility. I'm not proposing to change that fee. So right now it's $1,000 if it's a special permit, $500 if it's not a special permit. My suggestion is to keep that the same. Under special permit, all others. So this is... This is one of those circumstances where I haven't really known what to do because it wasn't covered in our fee schedule. My suggestion is to have the fee be $300 flat. Right now, the flat fee for a couple of the special permits that are actually listed is $150. So that would be a doubling of the fee. Then, we move to other scenic road. I'm proposing to increase that fee to $300. Currently it's $250, so it's only a small increase. Then the next fees for repetitive petitions, right now there is no fee. So that would be $300. Roadway acceptance, there is no fee, that's $300. There's quite a bit of work that goes into both of those applications, so I wanted it accounted for. And then I just wanted to add here that if people want to buy copies of the zoning bylaws, the master plan, the open space and rec plan, $25.
Okay. Does anyone have any...
Happy to answer questions or discuss.
So what's the technical review, the $8,000 in most cases? I'm looking at the comparison schedule and I don't see anybody. Is it, do other towns have that? And I'm just not seeing it.
Well, if you look at some of the fee schedules, so it's under technical review in the table. So, let's see.
I'm looking at the grid where you're comparing the other towns to us.
Yeah. Let me see
and
where
I don't see that anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Oh, is it? I'm not seeing it. There is a technical review fee that I put in my chart. It's very, most of the towns are very, very complicated.
Yeah.
Like, for example, Millbury. I can tell you what Millbury's is because I know it off the top of my head. So for Millbury, the technical reviews fee for subdivisions is $7,500. And for site plan reviews is $6,500. Why isn't it here?
And we didn't have it before because we're using staff. Is that now we have to hire a consultant?
Correct. Yeah, so we never had a prior fee. There is like some of the towns, the fee was super complicated. Like it was based on, like if you look under Shrewsbury, if you look at their site plan review fee, if I remember correctly, they had similar formulas for tech review. And I honestly, when I'm accepting an application, usually they're standing at the counter, and to go through this level of analysis while they're standing at the counter just to generate the fee is just not something I want to do. So that is why I'm recommending kind of a flat fee. You know, I can't see it here, but I have another version of this chart that I know definitely has that fee. So I'll email that to you so you can see how it's done in other towns.
So when the cost does come in lower than say $8,000, that goes back to the applicant for the overage?
So what I have done in Millbury, in the case in Millbury, there is no town engineer. So 100% of the projects go to the consulting engineer, except for, you know, tiny, tiny projects like in-law apartments and duplexes. Those projects would not generally go to the consulting engineer unless they triggered the stormwater management bylaw, which in Millbury is under the jurisdiction of the planning board instead of the conservation commission. So there were a few instances where I would suggest to an applicant, I would tell them, you know, there's no way I'm going to need $6,500 for the review of your project. It's a small project. So my recommendation to you is you to submit a waiver request letter. So, you know, I think I'll be fine with $3,500. So why don't you give me a check for $3,500 and then formally request a waiver from the balance of the tech review fee. So I did that on a number of occasions and it worked well. In this circumstance, small projects will hopefully be handled by the assistant DPW director, in which case I won't need to ask for any relief. We just won't ask for a fee.
Okay, any other questions?
I'm just curious when the last time these fees were all revamped. Do you have any ideas?
You know, let me look at my fund fee schedule. I think I have it.
If they had it, if they were voted on, it would be before me, and I started 2014.
Yeah.
Brought it with me.
Seems like they might be due for sure.
You know, it's in the rules and regulations at the back of the book. If one of you happen to have your book with you. I could also pull it up on the internet. I don't think, if my memory serves me right, I don't think that the date is listed.
Okay. I was just curious.
I'm going to
recent, then
pull it up.
You don't want to make too big of a jump for people, but if it's been 10 years, I think it's reasonable.
Yeah, I don't remember ever voting on them. And plus, I do think the advertising fees, I'm surprised we never charged them.
Yeah, I just pulled it up. And it says April 2015.
Okay, it's been 8 years.
I was on the board. I don't remember ever voting on it. I think I started, maybe I started in 2015. I don't know. Okay. So does everybody agree to meet with the ZBA on September 5th? Everybody think that's a good idea?
Yeah, I think so. Sure. It makes sense.
Okay. So if anybody has any other questions between now and then, you know, we can bring them up on the September 5th. But right now, to me, this looks good.
And, you know, we can advertise it. Maybe what I'll do is I'll color code it so it's more clear which fees would increase, which ones would stay the same. And then, you know, during the public hearing, we can adjust the fees if you want to do so.
Thank you so much for doing all this.
My pleasure. Sorry it took so long.
No, that's okay. We've had a lot on the plate.
Yeah, okay. You obviously have to be thorough.
Yeah. Yep, and I know.
Yeah, I definitely didn't want to price ourselves out of right. What the surrounding communities are doing. And right. Make it too arduous for the business, the private sector.
Right.
I'm sure once it's advertised to a lot of businesses, probably watch what we're doing. And if they have concerns, hopefully they'll attend the public hearing.
Yes.
Now, is that something you would actually send out to like local developers or just public hearing notice?
You know, it's really hard to do something like send it out to developers because then you get the complaints of, oh, you sent it to this person. Why didn't you send it to this person?
Absolutely.
And I'm so new to this community. I really only know the developers that have come forward during the year and a half I've been here. I probably will just, you know, of course I could send it to some of the frequent flyers like Marshall Gould and let him know so he can share that with his clients. But yeah, I'd be afraid of getting that criticism of plan favorites or whatever.
That's true. So it's probably best not to send it out.
It will be advertised in the Community Advocate. Yep. And of course it'll be on our webpage.
Okay. Thank you so much for doing that. All right, if no one has any more questions, we'll move on to the next agenda item. I actually want to go out of order again. Oh, I was going to talk about the sign and facade program that Lori did. I don't know if anyone had a chance to read it. I thought she did a great job with that too. That came out of, for those who don't know, it came out of the Master Plan Implementation Committee is what I'm assuming, because we had our third and final community meeting, June 20th. And many of the ideas, the final ideas, are pretty expensive. And they're also will take years to develop and developers to come forward. But something like a sign and facade program could be low-hanging fruit where you can start to make the downtown look a little nicer by working with some of the downtown businesses. So I don't know if everybody had a chance to read it, if you want Lori to review it quickly, or if anyone has questions, what would you like to do? Did anyone have a chance to read it?
Well, I read it, but I think having Lori do a quick review for, you know, anyone who might be online probably can't hurt.
Sure.
I'd be happy to do so. So the proposed program would be paid for with ARPA funds. And I did already submit the cover letter and program description, draft program description to the Board of Selectmen. And I'll be giving a presentation on it, I believe, in early September. Unfortunately, their next meeting is when I'm going to be on vacation, so I'm not going to be available to talk about it on August 14th. So the way I envisioned it is that I would request $250,000 of ARPA money, and there would be two different programs. There would be a sign program, and then there would be a facade program. The sign program would cap out at $2,000, and it would be a 50% matching program. So what that would mean is that if somebody had a $4,000 sign project, then they could pony up $2,000 themselves, and then the town would pay the balance of $2,000. So they would submit their sign design, which would be reviewed, and there would be a committee. They would ultimately decide whether to grant the grant application or not. So there would be various submittal requirements. There would be an application form. There would be approval from the landlord, miscellaneous submissions. There would also be a design from, the sign vendor, and pricing. So at the conclusion of the project, the sign would be verified that it was installed properly, that it was the appropriate sign that was actually approved, and then that the sign vendor was paid. And then the applicant would submit evidence that they paid the sign vendor, and this would be a reimbursement grant. So then at that time, the money would be reimbursed, the $2,000 to the applicant. So the facade program would work similarly, except it would be capped at $20,000. It would also be a matching program, so 50% would be contributed by the applicant, and 50% would be contributed by the town. So say it was a $30,000 project, applicant would pay $15,000, town would pay $15,000. There are a whole list of different activities that would be eligible under the facade program, including permanent landscaping, awnings, siding repair or replacement, new windows, new doors, walkway improvements, ramps for ADA accessibility, and the like. So the point of the facade program is that the improvements would have to be made to the street-facing facade. So this program would not fund to replace all of the windows in the building. It would just be to replace pretty much the windows at the front-facing facade. So the point is to get a dramatic impact at the street. So we don't care so much about the aspects of the buildings that are not visible from the street. So this would be an opportunity to improve code violations. In fact, those would be the priority. And also, pretty much everything that they do would have to be compliant with the code, building code, AAB, which is the Architectural Access Board, so that's handicap accessibility, zoning bylaws, etc. So this, because ARPA funds have to be fully committed by December 31st, 2024, this would be a short-term program. It would be a one one-time program unless we were able to have a, find alternative funding somewhere else, maybe a grant. So speed is of the essence. $250,000 will make a huge difference. However, it will also take a lot of time to review that number of applications and to spread the word. So of course we have to establish the program, then we have to advertise about the program, mail out flyers, you know, encourage people to apply. And then there's the application process. The funds have to be fully expended by, to my understanding, December 31st, 2026. So that means if the work is not completed by that date, they will not be reimbursed. The money disappears. So like I said, speed is kind of the essence with this particular program. But I think that it really has some great potential. Downtown commercial properties and businesses would be prioritized, but under the current program description, any commercial property would be eligible to apply, except for chain stores. They are exempt from the program.
Okay, I have some questions, but if anyone else has any questions, you could start.
Can you answer why chain stores would be exempt?
Because they usually have specific requirements from the headquarters on what they have to do to their buildings. So right. that is why. What we're trying to do with this program is help out the smaller
mm-hmm.
business, like the mom and pop shops. And of course, we have the entire Northborough Crossing, most of which is chain stores.
Yeah.
So it, you know, $20,000 doesn't go very far when you're talking okay. about Target.
Okay.
I'm wondering if it should be downtown only, like versus hitting all of them, since downtown was the focus of the master plan. Like maybe if you reach out to the whole town. I don't know. I was wondering if we should focus on downtown.
That's what I was telling
you. You know, we don't have a heck of a lot of commercial properties downtown. We have, you know, multifamilies, which would be exempt. You know, it would have to be a business or a commercial property occupied by business tenants. If we wanted to, you know, say I go to the Board of Selectmen and they say $250,000 is too much, I think you're being too ambitious, we're only going to give you $100,000. In that case, then I would absolutely think that we should just focus on downtown. That doesn't go very far at all.
Yeah, and to me, I would want to just focus on downtown. Or even Main Street, but I feel like if you're getting up to Northborough Crossing, then that is a lot of chain stores, and so they wouldn't be included anyways.
Yeah, I don't think the money's going to go very far, especially with the facades. I mean, you're talking, you know, maybe 20 or something after you put in the signs.
Did you have a question, Bill, before you had your hand up?
Yeah, I mean, you sort of answered my question because it was going to be about the, you know, about the area. So I really think we should really concentrate on downtown
mm-hmm.
and not open this up everywhere. But there's always that question of what exactly is downtown, right? How far does it go? But I think also when it comes to downtown, I think opening up to the chain stores like CVS, like Dunkin' Donuts, so that they can look like everything else downtown, I think is important and does provide that same look and feel, which is the point.
Right.
There are some commercial properties that are looking really rough, honestly, that are a little bit further down Main Street. I would not consider them part of downtown. And a little further down West Main Street, So that's really why I wanted to open it up to a broader area. One idea that we could do is we could say, you know, $150,000 is going to be specifically earmarked for downtown properties. But it, you know, years ago, I tried to do a similar program in Millbury, and I just didn't have the interest. In that case, it was a no interest loan program. And it was also a sign grant. And believe it or not, nobody applied, not a single entity. So one of my concerns is that if we limit it to the downtown, then we may just not have the interest. And then, you know, the program just falls apart.
During the MPIC process, did you ever mention it to any of the, I know it's early, but did you mention it to any of the businesses? Like, do you think, did you see any interest that any of the businesses would like help to fix up their signs or facades, or it hasn't been discussed yet, really?
You know, it hasn't really been discussed. The MPIC community meetings, I think, were largely attended by residents. There were some. We did have a business meeting pretty early on, and I think we only had maybe 10 people there.
Mm-hmm.
So there hasn't, it's hard. It's hard to get the interest of the business community.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, this program would provide matching money. But that means that they also need to have the money in the bank to be able to spend. So if they don't have the money in the bank, then they wouldn't be able to apply for the program. So it's, we want to make sure that they have skin in the game. You know, I'd hate to give $20,000 to a business that closes in 6 months.
Right.
You know, so we need to ensure that they're kind of stick around for a little while.
Yeah.
Another question I had, oops, sorry.
Nope, go ahead.
I had a question about the code violations. Like, what type of code violations are you thinking? Because I feel like there are some people who have put their money into their business and they don't have any code violations, yet you have offenders with code violations, and that's who we're going to give the money to. So I feel like, I don't know, I'm wondering what type of code violations you're talking about.
Major code violation may be that they have a step. So they are a retail store. So say they're a convenience store. And you have to step up from the sidewalk into the building. That's a code violation. They need to have a ramp that's ADA compliant. So that they would have to address that problem first. And then they could go into, you know, changing out their siding. It's important to address the violations before we get into the decorative stuff.
Okay.
What concerns me with that, though, is this is like a sign and facade program that had to do with the visualization of downtown, and people are going to be looking for downtown that, you know, looks different and looks nice, but they're not going to notice a ramp. It's a sign and facade. It's not like sign, facade, and ADA compliant program. Like, I feel like ADA compliant program would be a whole different pot of money and a different program.
Well, they look at it this way. If you are the person in a wheelchair who can't go into that business because of the fact that they have a step, that is far more important than, you know, whether they have, you know, brick siding or vinyl siding. It's, or whether they have a fancy new sign. To that particular individual and their family members, and the same is true with a restaurant, access is super important and it is mandated by law.
Yeah, so wouldn't the, so if it was like a convenience store and they didn't have the ramp, wouldn't they have to put it in? Like, isn't that a law that they have to do it?
It is, but what if they don't have the money to put it in? Because believe it or not, a ramp can be really, really pricey. You know, there was a business in Millbury, a very, very popular business. It used to be called the Sports Clip. I always forget the name of it now. It's Matt's at the Buzzer. And they're across the street from the post office. And they had a number of elderly clientele, and they had a big step up into their business. And they really, really wanted to address that problem. So they ended up putting like a little temporary ramp. So it kind of did the trick, but not gracefully. People in a wheelchair really needed to kind of be lifted onto the ramp and into the building. But then we did our phase two downtown revitalization project, and we were able to secure a grant so that he could have a fancy concrete ramp and railings to do it right. And, you know, the business owners were super happy. They really wanted to be ADA compliant. They really wanted to address that deficiency. That was a big priority for them. Sure. And we were able to make it happen through a partnership. So the same is true here. You know, I would like to see if there's a business in town with a similar problem, and they have clientele who are disabled and they want to address it, then I think personally, that would be a fantastic application to this program and a fantastic use of grant funds.
I agree,
make that accessible to people.
Then I think it should be the sign and facade and accessibility grant. Like, because I think the sign and facade is misleading if you were going to also do accessibility. Does Bob have a list of all the ADA complaints and violations downtown?
Do I have a list? No.
Yeah, does anyone have a list of who's not compliant?
I'm sure the building inspector does.
Yeah, it'd be interesting just to see how many there are and what they have to do and how much of it's
just one example. I mean, there are other examples of code violations, like, for example, doors. You know, handles of doors and lighting, and you know, there could be I imagine having to do with windows. So it's not just ADA. And you know, this program does pay for landscaping improvements, which certainly isn't a sign and it isn't a facade. But it would be, you know, permanent landscaping that could make a big difference to the overall look of a business. Mm-hmm. So they could do window boxes or, you know, permanent planters that are attached to the building, or, you know, there are a number of businesses that have really small landscape areas in front of their businesses. So it would be an opportunity to plant bushes and perennials. So
okay, that was just my concern.
Yeah, no, Amy, I think I'm with you as well. I think, you know, if there are code violations that we need to fix, maybe that's a separate program, right? And they have to go through that separate program, and we can, you know, again, we can put in ARPA funds to get that done, but it's a separate program than beautifying downtown. That's fixing up downtown.
My only issue with that is that, let's say somebody who has a ramp or something that is in a bit of disrepair, but it's still functional, and they really aren't, they're not going to be able to, they can't spend the money to put it into a more aesthetically pleasing appearance. So they either are going to let it kind of fall into that category of non-maintenance, or if they could get some help, if they could get some funding to help them put it in a nicer place or put it in a more aesthetically pleasing appearance, that benefits us as well, not just the business. So to have something, if they're going to do a ramp and they want it to look a certain way and be nicer, then they might be more encouraged to do that than to do it in a maybe less aesthetically pleasing way.
Yeah, but to me, that would still be
not to get around a code violation, but to really kind of manage it or deal with it in a way that benefits everybody.
I agree, but then you're talking facade. You're talking the look of the building, not you know, fixing the actual code violation. So if they don't have a ramp, that should be a different program than fixing up a ramp.
Oh, right? I see what you're saying.
Making it look nicer.
Yeah.
Right. So that's why I'm saying that's the two different programs.
Mm-hmm. I'll take it under advisement. But that's typically, you know, the way sign and facade programs are set up. This is a good opportunity to address problems that otherwise won't be addressed.
Okay.
And, you know, public safety, I have to say public safety trumps aesthetics. So, right. You know, I feel strongly that addressing code violations should be part of the program. So that's, I'll consider it, but that's the design of the program that I put forward.
Yeah, no, I completely agree that public safety should come first. That's why I'm saying there should be a separate program that addresses public safety specifically. That's where that money is earmarked, not money that's earmarked for, you know, a sign, a facade, or public safety.
Right.
Are you saying it's a little bit of a carrot, Lori, for them to do this?
You know, what I suspect is we're going to get a handful of applications.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, say somebody submits an application for $20,000 for aesthetic improvements. And then it turns out that there's some code violations that need to be addressed. And the total of that expense is an additional $5,000.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would do in this circumstance is I would say you're gonna address the code violations first, and then with the money that's left over, so you're capped at $20,000, with the money that's left over you can prioritize the aesthetic improvements that you want. Or, you know, it depends on the application. Maybe the committee has certain aesthetic improvements that they want addressed first. But that is why it's so important to have the building inspector be part of the conversation, so we can identify code violations for specific applications that are before the committee. So, because, like I said, public safety needs to come first.
I totally agree. I just feel like Bill was saying, and that's what I was saying to begin with, it seems like two separate programs. Like, there could be a code safety and accessibility program and a sign and facade. Because if I was a business and I saw a sign and facade program, I might not even apply because it doesn't sound like it would fit help with accessibility. I don't know. I feel like they're two different programs.
Well, I can just make it clear in the description what's included.
But I think the residents would have to know too, because, and I know everybody thinks accessibility is important, but to me, I thought this was the first part of the downtown revitalization. And if they're using their ARPA monies for a sign and facade, yeah, it would have to be known as sign, facade, and accessibility, or, you know, I don't know.
Accessibility is just one example of a code violation. Right. Like I said, there could be many more, and, you know, I'm just reaching from this guy. Bob's not here. I'm sure he could, you know, tick them off.
It could be a program, though, where we spend $100,000 of taxpayer ARPA money and then you don't see a difference, and everybody will say, well, we gave $100,000 to sign in facades, but no signs and facades were done, you know, but we spent the money.
I really don't see that happening. You know, there are a number of properties, and I'm sure when you drive up up Route 20, you know which ones I'm talking about,
mm-hmm.
that have a whole host of problems, some of which are aesthetic, some of which are code violations. You know, any improvement to these properties is probably a big improvement.
The only other concern I had, and Lori knows this concern, is the current membership of the committee would be Lori, Bob, and a member of the design review. And I think Lori's great, and I think Bob is great. But I am concerned about a committee where, you know, staff has two votes and the one of the voted residents has one vote. So I was thinking there should be like a facade committee where it could be either the design review plus one extra person, either from the BOS or MPIC, to make it an even number, or it could be a new facade committee that's just, it's a short-term committee and it has a select board member, a planning board member, two MPIC members, and design review. And that would be five people. And Bob could review all the codes, you know, for the application, and Lori could review it for the zoning and give input, and the committee makes the decision. But that's just my input.
And, you know, as I mentioned in the email, I have a couple of concerns about that. Number one is this program has an ultimate deadline. First of all, I don't even have any funding yet. So if I go to the select board, the middle of September, and if they bless the program, it's going to take a while to put the program together, to launch the program, advertise the program. And then all of that money needs to be committed within a 1 year time frame. And then the work has to be, you know, depending upon some facade projects, $40,000 projects. Of course, we're relying on trades and their work schedules. Mm-hmm. And even though it may only take 2 weeks to do the work, it may take 6 months to schedule the work and actually have them show up and do the work. So I'm just concerned about the timeline. You know, of course, design review is already busy. They meet once a month. They're already busy with reviewing applications, development applications under approval in a jurisdiction of the planning board and the ZBA. We have had challenges getting all of the members to show up. You know, of course, most of them, half of the members have full-time jobs. And, you know, Bob and I are full-time. We're there 40 hours a week. And so we can be very responsive. You know, it'd be great if Dario, being an architect, I'm sure he would have some great ideas for how to improve some of these storefronts. And he can lend that expertise to the applicants that come before the committee. I just feel that we'll be able to do more with full-time staff than we would be able to do with volunteer committees that already have other work to do.
In my view, it would go to staff and you guys would get the applications and work with them and figure out what you want to see and how you want to do it. And then it would be the committee that would take the final applications and vote on them. I don't know. I think staff would definitely be involved throughout the whole process, but I do think there needs to be a committee involved too, just because in the past, and I know, you know, I trust you and others, but in the past, you know, we'll get something in and then they'll say, well, that's not what we were thinking, or that's not what the town was looking for. Just someone to run it by that's been on the board for a long time or been in town for a long time and is listening, and you're listening to the residents, but hear the residents' complaints. And I don't know. I just feel like it should be a committee with input from staff.
Are you saying, Amy, have another whole committee on this?
Well, we could do a facade committee, but it wouldn't be, you wouldn't go out to pick a committee. It would be like one member from the planning board, one member from the Board of Selectmen, two members from the MPIC, and we could pull Dario from design review. So it wouldn't be like you go out to a whole new committee, but it would be a committee like the CPC. You get all the applications, they review them, they discuss them, they think, okay, this does fit with what the master plan wanted. This fits with what we're looking for in town. And then approve the ones that you only, if you have 100,000 or 200,000, they approve which ones they think fits best for the program. But they get input from staff.
I was also envisioning that this would be a rolling process. So the applications come in and then decisions are made. First come, first served. So it wouldn't really be a competition. It would be a, okay, we've got this amount of money and we have to expend it all within a 1 year time frame. So the shame would be to get to the end of the year and still have the vast majority of the money uncommitted. So there would be a 30-day turnaround, rolling admission.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think there could be a committee that would have an answer within 30 days also if they're meeting once.
I don't know about that.
I'm not a big committee, out of committee person myself. I think that just adds, you know, I understand you're wanting the input, but at the same time, I'd hate to not be able to capitalize on this because we can't pull people together to discuss it. It just, I think that adds a layer of time that might miss, we might miss the opportunity.
Lori, can you confirm the timelines for me in terms of, I know it's the end of this year to be committed, but doesn't that just mean that we've agreed to set this money aside to do that, right?
Yeah, so the money would have to be committed by the end of December 2024. So right now I don't have any money.
Oh, wait.
So I have no program. So the right. program would have to be set up and then it would have to be advertised. So it would have to be promoted to the commercial and business community. So that is going to take a while. And then of course I imagine people don't necessarily, you know, they're going to have to ponder and they're going to see, okay, well, you know, here's this program available. I wasn't expecting this. So I'm interested in applying. Let me think about what I can do. Then they're going to have to get three quotes. And anybody who's done any sort of home repairs, I'm sure will understand how challenging it can be to get contractors to show up and give you quotes. They're for facade improvements, depending upon what type of improvement, they may have to involve the services of an architect to do a design for them. So that is another period of time. Under the facade program, up to $5,000 of the grant money could be used for architectural services. So, you know, it's just not going to be as easy to shove this money out the door within that year time frame. That is my concern. And then when we add a committee into the mix, you know, what if an applicant appears before the committee and then, you know, people have different ideas of what the facade of the building should look like? And so then, you know, instead of it being one meeting, then it draws out to four meetings before this committee, before a project gets approved. You know, I'm just concerned because of the deadline. If this were a program that was being started using municipal funds, and there wasn't the deadline, then I think there wouldn't be as much of a timing pressure.
I think we'd need guidelines and examples then, because what if, like, the town has an idea about what they want for facades, and then, I don't know, and then this small committee decides, well, no, we're going to do it this way. Like, for the longest time downtown, we talked about interlit signs or externally lit signs. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, you know, there's a sign like the Budweiser sign downtown, and that's probably a code violation. And we say, hey, we're going to put a big new Budweiser sign over the liquor store, and then the staff thinks it's a great idea because it's fixing a code violation. But I would think the committee would say, oh no, you know, that's not what we want for the look downtown. We don't want a big Budweiser sign hanging over the sidewalk. And that's just an example, but I
think that, Amy, I'm sorry, but you know, I am a professional who has many years of experience in this field of work. I have a master's degree in regional planning. I've written design guidelines. We have design guidelines. My preference, of course, is to have an architect on this board. The design guidelines are the guide. If you look at the design standards that are put into the sign and facade program, it specifically says that internally lit signs won't be funded under the program. So I just wish that you folks had more faith in your professionals. I mean, I was hired to be your guide, and I guess I kind of find it insulting that you don't think that I could recognize a nice sign from an ugly sign.
I'm not trying to insult you, but we've been burned in the past. And
well, this is the person who, we're only talking about a year. I mean, granted, I could be hit by a bus tomorrow, so I can't say for 100% certainty that is going to be me, but it's going to be a professional planner with many years of experience who is trained to do this sort of thing. I mean, this is my expertise. And the building inspector has many, many years of experience, as well as education on all things code and zoning. So I would think between the three of us, I would like the guidance of a professional architect. I think that having an architect on this little committee would be fabulous. But I think, you know, that certainly we would do a good job.
Have you reached out to Dario yet? I'm just curious.
I have not.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I think it's a great program. I'd like to get Carrie's input when she's back in September too. I think you're going to go to the selectmen in September. So
yes, this is not under the jurisdiction of the planning board, but certainly I'm happy to take any sort of feedback. Mm-hmm. But ultimately the program design would be blessed by the select board.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. So if anybody else has any concerns, comments, we could send them to Lori, or, you know, we could add it to the next agenda if Carrie had anything she wanted to add.
He's also welcome to email me any suggestions, any of you are.
Right.
So I don't think we have to put it as an agenda item in September. If you folks have, you have the document, if you had any suggested wording changes, There are design standards in there. If you want to suggest any other design standards, I'm totally open to that.
Great.
Yeah. Actually, Hudson, and I don't know if I sent it out, Hudson had a great article that came out last week, and it showed their before and after of their facades downtown.
Yeah.
And it was a huge difference in shaping the downtown.
Mm-hmm.
So if I didn't send it out, or we can send it out too. But I was thinking those are good ideas for what we want to see going forward too. Okay. Unless anyone else has any other comments, the last thing I had on the agenda was for town meeting bylaws. And I just wanted to add it to kick off that it's that time of year. If anyone has any ideas, we don't have to talk about them tonight. I had some that I started sending to Lori, but they most had to do with 709020, which is the site design section from its design review. And it had to do with like downtown. And I'm trying to think of a couple of them off the top of my head. One that they had in Millbury and we've talked about before was that you can say like in the downtown or Main Street, the materials used on the outside of the building where it's not metal, you know, so you're not going to get a metal warehouse building. It's just simple things like that. And there was something, let's see if I have it, what I sent her. It was just ideas that I've thought about while we're sitting on design review. One of the things I want to talk about would be updating the sign bylaw, whether through the planning board or design review can tackle it, because I think we'll have suggestions after going through MPIC. At the last community meeting, Lisa Maselli, one of the selectmen, actually asked Rick Leaf, you know, 2 years ago we tried to do a sign bylaw and we were told wait till after the master plan. So she asked Rick Leaf, did we get any input for the signed bylaw from the consultants? And he said, no, that would have to go through design review. So we were thinking of starting again and getting input and trying to put together a signed bylaw, mostly like something to do with window signs. If you notice downtown, there's a big, I'm gonna pull something out.
Well, you're pulling that up. I do have a question.
Sure.
That I think is very curious about the sign bylaw. Why does the sign bylaw prohibit the names of businesses to be on awnings? Because that's pretty common that the name of the business is on the skirt of an awning. And I actually really like that. I think it's really tasteful. Anybody have any history on why that's not allowed?
That's been in there for a long time.
That might be something that we might want to reconsider.
Yeah, if that's been in there, I was not aware of it because I have one.
And I think you're violating the sign bylaw.
Apparently I am, but hey.
And I think Tavern on the Square has it too. Like, yeah, I think there are certain things in there that we can change. We can go through it bit by bit. One thing that we don't have is a lot of towns define window signs, and window signs are only 25% of your window.
Mm.
We actually don't even have any definition for window signs. So actually it's supposed to be, if not permitted, then prohibited. But I find there are certain buildings downtown. Do you see the one I'm sharing now?
Mm-hmm.
Where the building is covered with Coke signs and stuff. And there are probably ways to just make that a little nicer. And it would come a long way with fixing the downtown.
I don't disagree.
There are a couple of buildings down there and they're actually not even prohibited. They're not even permitted by our bylaws right now.
Yeah, I think something could be cleaned up on that. and signs leaning against buildings, yeah.
Right. And also, one of the things I wanted to change in the sign bylaw is a percentage. The wall signs right now are 32 square feet, whether you're small or big. So if you're a small little building, 32 square feet might be too big for the wall. But if you're someone like Wegmans, 32 square feet is too small, too big, right. Too small. So yeah. A lot of towns have your sign is like 20% of your wall size.
Right. Yeah.
You know, so it's not just a set number. Those are some of the ideas. And looking into the awnings, that would be a good idea. There probably aren't that many changes, and maybe we can try to do a table. Mm-hmm. I pulled it up again and started, but. So we can either do that as a planning board, or we could try to have design review tackle the first phase of it, and then bring it to the planning board for input. It's up to what you feel. If we have time to do it this fall or not. And we don't even have to decide tonight, but that was one of the ones on my list. Another one for downtown I was thinking is changing right now. Our downtown says we need, we have the lot frontage is 6 feet. And a suggestion I had was going back to 10 to 15 because in other towns you need 10 feet at least to put in a good sidewalk. Like if you really want the sidewalks are 4 to 5 feet deep and you need grass space, you want rooms for lanterns or planters, or if there is restaurants, you want room for tables. So 6 feet frontage in the downtown is probably too small to get a good sidewalk.
You know, I think that's something that can be negotiated through site plan review, because I wouldn't want a circumstance where the building is pushed back. I think it's really important to have the building up to the sidewalk edge, but the setback, I don't think people are thinking about sidewalk going in front of the frontage of the building. In many instances, it ends up being landscaping. And then right now, one of the problems that I see, one of the major problems is so many of the buildings are set back too far from the road, and then they have the parking in front. So it just, it breaks up the edge, the street edge. So what you want people to feel is you want them to feel like they're in a room, pedestrians, when they're walking along a street. And so the facades of the building create the walls of the room. So I would recommend keeping the 6 foot setback. I would actually recommend zero setback, front setback. But if you folks want landscaping in the front, then 6 feet is certainly ample to do it. I don't think that setback is going to be occupied by sidewalk.
But isn't it mandatory that they put in a sidewalk?
Well, it depends on the configuration of the building, you know. So typically what you see with the newer buildings is the sidewalk is 5 feet along Route 20. And then you have a walkway that goes from the sidewalk to the building. So in front of the building is not sidewalk, it's landscaping.
I guess this is just what I pulled out of other bylaws. They said with the new, you know, they must have restaurants downtown or like donut shops. They said it had to do with the new like COVID outdoor dining, that you want to leave more room for pedestrian access and for anyone who would want to put a table out front and still be able to walk past it.
But the sidewalk is not, the sidewalk is within the public right of way. It's right. Not on the property. So you don't want to have the sidewalk there because of the liability reasons. So, you know, when you see that expanded sidewalk, the commercial property front line is typically at the edge of the sidewalk, and the sidewalk is within the right of way. So the expansion of the sidewalk would be within the limits of the right of way. not on the commercial property. So when I did my downtown revitalization project, we expanded sidewalks quite a bit, but we expanded the sidewalk in the right of way, the road. We didn't go on private property to do that.
We can't do that on Route 20. Like we were told by Mass DOT, right? We can't take away any lanes.
I think we're kind of, you know, limited because if you have 5-foot sidewalks, I mean, what we can say is we can say, okay, you're going to be a restaurant. We want outdoor seating out front. So that can be negotiated. So then they're doing a patio on their property that they own. They're not doing a sidewalk. They're doing a patio.
Mm-hmm.
So the sidewalk is what's within the road right of way. So it might look like a sidewalk, but it's not. It's a patio.
Mm-hmm.
I just find the last couple, like down past Dunkin' Donuts, they're like, well, it's only 6-foot frontage, so they go all the way. They want to even put their buildings all the way up to the edge, which but didn't that, leave any room.
That was a major change that was made, in, I think, when the zoning was completely redone in 2009, 2011 timeframe.
Yeah.
So there used to be a front setback. So that's mm-hmm. why so many of the buildings have the parking out front, because that used to be a mandatory front setback. So they fixed that when they made the front setback only 6 feet. So now the newer buildings that have been built since then are closer to the sidewalk edge.
There have been a couple.
That's what you want. You want the building on the sidewalk edge.
Mm-hmm.
Right. They usually go for a variance, though, a lot of them that have been built since 2009 that are set really far back. Because I do think there is a maximum of being set back 20 feet downtown. Like it's 6 feet, but then max is 20 feet. But then there have been people who go in front of the ZBA and say, well, we need to go back further.
I would never recommend that the ZBA approve something like that. Because the direction that we're heading in is more of a classic downtown with a sidewalk sit on the sidewalk, the sidewalks. The buildings sit on the sidewalk edge.
Yeah.
So even if a single application varies from that, then you're setting yourselves back 50 years because there isn't going to be another opportunity until that building is demolished. So,
Yeah. You just can't leave Northboro then.
That's right.
Because we get another planner and they say, well.
Well, I totally think, you know, the zoning bylaws are pretty good, in my opinion. They did a really nice rewrite back in that 2009-2011 timeframe.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there hasn't been much of an opportunity to see changes since then because it was, you know, in planning world, it was just yesterday. So those changes will come forward over the next decades, and then you'll really see the difference. So the important thing is just stick with it. But the 6-foot setback, I think, is fabulous. And then there's zero side setbacks, zero rear setback. That's going to enable the buildings to butt up against each other. And that's what we want for a pedestrian-friendly downtown.
Hmm. Yeah. I don't know. I just took it from other, you know, I looked at it. It was sent out, the one from Milton. And they talked about, you know, giving more room out front for tables and access and wider sidewalks. So that was the only reason why I brought it up.
Yeah, and like I said, that's on a patio.
Yeah.
A patio would do that for a restaurant. So, but that's, you know, that's kind of, there has to be some sort of individuality to the review of applications. You know, and that's why a ZBA is good, because it allows you with that flexibility. If everybody just had to go with the zoning the way it is, then, you know, it would be really hard because you really can't take a one size fits all approach. Especially, you know, a convenience store versus a restaurant. Yeah, the convenience store should be right up to that sidewalk edge. But I don't see the benefit of having anybody set back from the sidewalk edge other than a restaurant. And I think you can accomplish that with a patio or a deck.
Okay. And there were a couple others. I don't have them in front of me that I had brought up. And, you know, we're going to have to work on the MBTA community. And one thing, I don't know if anyone had time to read, but I sent out what Lexington did. And so we can use some of Lexington. And then Lori sent out Chelmsford too, and some of their ideas going forward.
Yeah, for some reason, I wasn't able to open some of them. So I'd like to definitely look at them again.
Yeah. Yeah. One of the ideas I had when I looked at Lexington is, you know, Lexington used a lot of properties that already were developed. They didn't use all open parcels. So I got concerned if we're going to do the baseball field and we're going to do the Zero Hudson that was 14 acres in the Harvey, then we're doing all properties that could be developed. Where Lexington said they wanted slow growth, so they didn't pick 25 acre developable properties. They picked, like, you could pick 25 acres in a row that are all 1 acre properties, and that can be your property. So when I was thinking of Zero Hudson Street, I was thinking if we're going to give a developer rights to do 15 units per acre, maybe we want to pick something that has been an issue in the past, like maybe do it on SA Farms or Tadabi or a site where it would make a difference to the people in town. Because Judy Barrett analysis said that that Zero Hudson Street can be 190 units. And when you read the Lexington bylaws, they figured like you could get like up to 160 units on like 3 or 4 acres. So even if Zero Hudson Street could not develop all 14 acres, if they had like 5 acres that were developable, they still might be able to get like 150 units up there. And that concerned me, along with the baseball and along with other properties. Like, I see Northborough as wanting slow growth also. So I just was taking a look at different properties. And also they included like downtown by going above their 50 acres. They're hoping that the state passes that they can use mixed use as part of their parcels by going above their 50 acres. So it might be something that Northborough could do downtown too, but we're gonna wait to see what happens if their bylaw gets passed by the Attorney General approved. Because they already went to the meeting.
Follow up with them just because I had questions. And what they said is that they created absolutely gigantic district, including 250 acres. So they were only required by law to create 50 acres. So there are a number of areas that are kind of questionable in accordance with the guidance. So of course, if Northborough wants to rezone 250 acres, then we have a lot of flexibility on which 50 acre piece we submit to the state for compliance. I have concerns. Of course, we are aiming for acceptance at the April 2024 town meeting. I really want to get moving on the actual bylaw. We've been talking about properties for about 6 months now. And, you know, we have the analysis that is required by the state on these certain properties. So the Avalon, the Southwest Cutoff, and the downtown properties, which of course we talked, I think it was for an hour and a half about that at the last meeting. And we came up with a consensus for the properties that were going to be evaluated. So I did ask Judy Barrett for a scope of work. I did speak with Trammell Crowe, And Mark Baranski is willing to pay Judy Barrett's fee, which is $32,000, to help us develop a bylaw. They are not, Trammell Crow is not saying that, you know, the bylaw has to be what they want. This would be a bylaw that the planning board would be happy with, not that Trammell Crow is directing. And so, but, you know, if this is something that you folks are interested in doing, we really need to pull the trigger on it, because Judy Barrett is a busy woman. And you know how long it takes us to prepare any sort of zoning bylaw changes. I think we spent about 6 months last year talking about the zoning bylaw changes that were ultimately proposed at last year's town meeting. So I'd like to move forward with the properties that have already been discussed, but I need your support.
Right now, I think we need, like, Lexington did 10 public hearings. Like, they had the public come 10 different times to look at the different areas they were picking and give input. I've had people reaching out to me about the baseball. The baseball did an application over in Shrewsbury, and they had 200 units. And they had four of them that were three bedrooms, and the rest were two and one in studios. And they got 30 kids in the school system, they said. In our town, they want to do 38 three bedrooms. I think that will add a lot of kids to the schools. And I want to be able to talk to them and to see what they're willing to work with. They said that they would be willing to do something close to Shrewsbury. I'd like to see if they could come down on the three bedroom units. I talked to someone in the school system, and they said that our schools, even though they've been declining, they have class size, and they thought adding a big group of kids is definitely going to have an impact. And if we pick Zero Hudson also, and that's developed for another 160 units, I mean, we're adding 300 units, 160 units, and I'm concerned. Lexington did not pick big parcels that were easily developable all at once. They picked some, so they wanted slow growth. And
Zero Hudson is going to be very difficult to develop. It's a hillside. It's very steep slopes. They're not going to be able to get that density. And you know, that you have the opportunity to negotiate a development agreement with Trammell Crow. None of the other areas present that opportunity. So those specific items can be negotiated through the development agreement. But the bylaw is what I'm concerned with. I'm concerned with having sufficient time to develop the bylaw and to go forward with it, with the sufficient, you know, amount of public hearings and discussion. You know, do you folks support having Judy Barrett, or is this something that you want me to just do myself? Because we don't have the funding to hire a consultant. So I really need some direction, some real solid direction from you folks. Are we going forward with the properties that had been previously agreed to by this board last month, or are we going with different properties?
We asked Judy to do a couple extra too in the minutes, and those weren't done. So, I mean, I thought we met once and we were throwing out random, like, oh, let's do the dentist, let's do this, let's do this, let's look at this. I didn't think this was, we make our decision at one meeting and that's the final. I thought we could analyze different properties.
I think we've talked about it at four meetings.
Yeah. Can I just, so really quick, number one, we did discuss this. We discussed all of the properties that we were going to look at. Mm-hmm. the baseball property is going to get done whether it's part of the 50 acres or not. So why not add it? It makes no sense to have that property developed and yet not add it into the 50 acres. Then you're adding more onto it, not less. You're not helping anything.
Baseball. Well, so zone is industry. Chances are it'll be a warehouse. I mean, that is the likely scenario, is that it's going to be developed into a warehouse or distribution center. That is how it is zoned.
We've been talking for
years. He is no longer interested in maintaining the baseball.
Right. But either way, right, it doesn't matter. We made our choice, right? We went through an hour and a half and made our choice as a board and agreed. That's what we've got to move forward with. We can't change our minds halfway through and expect to get this done. We're going to lose out on grant money. This town is going to lose out in the long run if we do that.
I mean, honestly, I feel like we could sit and debate this for another year. And at some point, I think the decisions and the discussions and the expertise and the you know, what has been brought before us is pretty thorough. And yes, we can always get new information along the way that may or may not have an impact. But I think we need to go forward with what we've already spent, I think, a goodly amount of time and been pretty thorough.
Yeah, I don't agree. It was June 6th, I read the minutes, and we were like, well, how about this? Well, how about that? In my mind, that was last minute. We're discussing the properties. We're throwing out different properties, but we didn't go in and look at the GIS map. I went back, looked at the GIS map. We have Chedabi, that's a hazardous waste site that you could use in the MBTA and then help fix up that property. You have SA Farms. You even have Zero Bartlett, where you can use 20 acres of Zero Bartlett to possibly be houses. And I'm sure the neighbors would like that better than a warehouse. Like, I thought we were having Judy look at the downtown and do an analysis, and we get the analysis back and it says 190 units and a baseball is gonna be 300 units. And I just think it's a lot for this town to absorb. And I got the time to read the Lexington bylaw and I looked at how they did it. And I do think that if we jump the gun, we'll regret some of the decisions we've made. And I don't wanna do that. One other thing Lexington did, and I'm hoping we can do it, is they hired someone to do an analysis that showed that you could do 15% affordable housing. So it doesn't have to be 10%. If you do a feasibility study showing that the developer will get a profit if you do 15%, and Lexington did that and they proved it. So instead of getting the 10% affordability, they can get 15%. And I'd like to see if we could do the same.
Right, but they did that a year. They started that process a year and a half ago. We don't have a year and a half anymore. Right. Our time is up. It has to be done by, it has to be at April town meeting. We don't have the time.
What if it doesn't pass? Like, you could say Zero Bartlett tomorrow.
Then it doesn't pass, and you know what? The town made the decision to pass on state grants. The town made that decision. The only thing we can do, our job here, is to recommend a best course of action. And time is up.
And I think also the downtown, if I may, we've been talking about the downtown through the MPIC for, you know, close to a year now. And we've had that community outreach. We've done the community forums, three of them, plus the business forum. And we've been talking a lot about multifamily housing and mixed use housing and providing those in the downtown. And also as a way of attracting the grant money that we need for the infrastructure improvement. The grant money is following the housing. So I don't think it's been a fly by night. We've been discussing it and evaluating, not just through this the planning board, but also through the master plan implementation committee and those community forums.
Zero Hudson was thrown on last meeting.
No, I've been talking about Zero Hudson since last January, at least, because I've been trying to encourage you folks to pick downtown properties because I know that that's how I'm going to get grant money. If there's no multifamily housing, no zoning change in the downtown, then the town is going to have to pay for the infrastructure improvements. We're not going to be able to get grants for it.
Right. But
and if we don't comply, we're not going to be able to get any grants, period, for anywhere.
Right. We've never gotten them before. We've never gone for any of those grants before. But 63 Main and 77 Main are still downtown without Zero Hudson. And you can take that 15 acres and do Tradabi or SA Farms and fix up an area that's been a problem for our town for 20, 30 years. Or we can give it to the Zero Hudson guy and then we'll just have more multi-use housing downtown and not fix the problem.
So Lori, I know you've wanted a decision like today. What is our, like, what's our drop dead to get, to say this is what we're going to do?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? I couldn't hear you very well. You're very soft on my computer. I don't know if everybody else finds you soft.
Let me just see if it's... Is it any better or is it the same?
It's pretty much the same. Yeah. And maybe you can just speak loud.
I'll speak up. So I do. I think we have to get this done. But like, what is our timing? What, I know you'd like to do this tomorrow. If we don't make a decision tonight, which I don't think we're going to, is it by next meeting? Do we have to have this kind of ironed out or?
I would like the bylaw written by January.
Which
so here it is, August.
Right.
It's going to take a couple of months to write the bylaw.
Right.
You know, I mean, of course, if I'm writing it in a vacuum, which I can do, I'd be happy to. It would be easier for me to write it if, I'm just putting in what I want. But if this is something that, I assume you folks want to be part of, then we're going to need a few meetings to get it to the point where you're happy. So by January is when I want to get to the point where I'm advertising the public hearing. So the bylaw you should all be happy with the bylaw in January. So it needs to be written. You need to have made your suggested changes and it should be ready to go in January. So that gives us August, September, October, November, December. So we have 5 months.
And we can use bits and pieces from like Lexington and Westford. Like to
Well, Lexington is a very different community. And chances are that their areas are very different with a different character. Like, for example, the character of the Hudson Street area is very different than the character of Southwest Cutoff. So I wouldn't want to have the same design standards for both. So, it becomes difficult when you just take stuff from another community and you're not applying the context to it. So, I would not want to just take Lexington's bylaw and use it as our own. I would think that would be inappropriate.
Oh, I agree. I think you can take it as a starting point and tweak it though. Like when you read it, it has the purpose, it has like the major points, and then they do their overlay. And that's what we would have to do, our overlay. But I don't know. I don't think we should rush it, even if it had to be later next year. And I'm not trying to drag it out, but I don't want to make a mistake either. This is going to have big consequences on our town going forward. Lexington was very strong to get their 15%. They're the first ones to get it done. We're not the only ones that are like just starting. They're the first ones. And they made sure they got their 15%. They made sure they're getting slow growth so they don't overcrowd their schools. I'm concerned. Like, is there any way to do a study of Zero Hudson? Right now she says 190 units can go there. Is there any way to see? You're saying that it's very difficult to develop. Is there any way that someone can do a quick analysis and say, well, Judy Barrett says 190, but I only think we're gonna do 30 units. Like, how do we know for sure how many he can actually develop there?
Well, I mean, probably the best way to do it is to have an engineer do a layout. That's so, I mean, it would require a survey.
With that 190, was she considering the whole property acreage or just with that kind of that front more flat area?
I just don't see that he's going to take the top off the mountain. I mean, that is when you have an opportunity to use design guidelines that specify the heights of the buildings, you know, the distance between buildings, the parking requirements, the open space requirement. You can specify about the slopes that are developable. Like, for example, I did a by right open space community bylaw that said that you couldn't, that all slopes of 15% or greater had to be included in permanently protected open space. So there are all sorts of things that you can do. We mandated that buildings had to be a minimum of 20 feet apart. You know, we had a requirement that said that 50% of the overall parcel side had to be permanently protected open space. And within that open space, there were design standards for how much of that land had to be actually classified as buildable. So there are a number of things that can be done. I just want to get moving with it.
Would it fly with MBTA though? Like, could you say, I don't think you could say mandatory 50% open space.
There are certain things that they put in there. You can't say that you can't limit bedrooms. You can't limit apartment sizes, but it, as far as I know, it doesn't say anything about open space. You have to be able to accommodate 15 units per acre. That's what it says in the bylaw, but it's not, you know, all parcels aren't the same. So even though the zoning bylaw says it's 15 units per acre, if the topography is such that you can't do 15 units per acre, then it's going to be something less than that.
Right. But if he has like five that are developable and you can squeeze the whole 190 units on those 5 acres, then the other acreage won't matter.
Well, like, you wouldn't be able to do that. How would you be able to do that? When you have parking requirements, when you have height requirements, when you have distance between buildings, how are you going to be able to get 190 units on 5 acres when all of that needs to be accommodated within that 5 acre area? So the limiting factor in that circumstance most likely is the topography of the land and the parking requirement and the height restriction.
I'd have to go back to Lexington because I just got it last week, but they could fit 160 units on 3 to 5 acres. And when I saw that, I'm like, okay, now Zero Hudson, if he has 3 to 5 acres, he could possibly put the 160 units.
Well, the problem is, and I know this, in Lexington, their building height requirements are much more than ours are.
Yep.
I actually have a friend of mine who works out there with the town. They have no open available space out there. People are buying houses, tearing them down and rebuilding mansions. That's what they do in Lexington. They don't do that in Northborough, right? It's a whole different environment. So you can't really use what their standards are. You can use their template, sure, but you can't use their standards. They're completely different.
Right, no, but that's what they had an analysis done on how much you could fit.
Right, but the analysis was based on what their standards are. Their standards are different than ours.
Right.
And the planner did write to me. She said that there are three overlay districts. Most of them are 40 feet if a project is only residential, but they allow 60 feet in the village overlay district if there's mixed use, and up to 115 feet in another area if a project is mixed use.
Right.
I am not envisioning 115 feet here in the town of Northborough. No way.
No, but I still think with 40, 50 feet, you can get a lot of units in. I mean, we could look at the size that they even did on the baseball field. I don't know how many acres they used to get their 300 units.
I mean, can we negotiate? Can we negotiate with the baseball field to be less than that 350 or 300, whatever it was?
315 is what they wanted, which is quite a bit below 15 units per acre.
Okay. Well, I think 15 units per acre was like 400. So, but 38 units, like they made the promise. This is just like Shrewsbury. But when I compared it to Shrewsbury, like I said, there were 4 3-bedroom units in Northborough. There are 38 3-bedroom units, and that's a high amount. Like 38, even if you have the 1.6 kids, that's 60 kids just in the 38 3-bedrooms.
So they are proposing, as you remember, they are proposing largely 1 2-bedroom units. So their density would be 11.6 units per acre. So that's quite a bit below. And they said that they want it to be a luxury development. So all of that can be negotiated in the development agreement.
Yeah, I'm hoping there's still a little negotiation left. But if we say that tonight, we're definitely going to do this site, this site, this site, they say, okay, negotiations out the door because they've picked us.
No, it's not out the door, because just because we're moving forward with the bylaw development doesn't mean that it will be brought to town meeting. We just need to get moving.
I agree with getting moving, but I do think we have to be careful and not just pick the first couple sites we looked at. I do think there are other opportunities. And you could start the bylaw still. Whether the bylaw is on top of Zero Hudson or SA Farms, it could still be the same bylaw.
I would probably change because one area is downtown, the other area is, you know, on West Main Street. So the character of those two areas is very different. You know, the area that you're talking about is in between two industrial properties, I believe.
It's industrial and residential.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It abuts that single family neighborhood. I know what the cul-de-sac. So, you know, well, at least you said I can move forward. So I'm going to start putting something together. It would be helpful to be able to say whether you want Judy Barrett's assistance, so you are committing to Southwest Cutoff, or I should just say, you know, forget it, we're gonna do it in-house.
Well, can we wait for Carrie to come back? She's our chair and she might have some input too. Like, I know we were talking about it tonight, but I'd like to hear what she has to say too.
Okay, you can postpone it till September.
I think the basics, we could start with the bylaw. But I mean, you're going on vacation anyways, too.
Right. Yes, I will be gone the week of the 14th.
And we'll be back September 5th.
Great.
I didn't have time to do the minutes. I don't know if anyone else did.
Okay.
I did, but it's fine.
Okay. And that way Carrie can read them too when she gets back.
Aren't we obligated to get some of these, like the March and April minutes, done?
I think in theory we're supposed to have had those done.
Right, but we just got them. When I looked at the March, I looked at the June and I was fine with that. But when I looked at the March, it was a 4 to 6 hour meeting and we had one pages of minutes.
Yeah.
So I was looking at that a little more closely.
Can we approve? Did anybody look at some of them or did some people not get to see any of them?
I looked at them.
I'm up to May.
Because I mean, we can get the ones that we, April 14th.
I didn't look at any.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I was reading the Lexington bylaws and the other things.
Okay.
I started looking at March, but when I saw one page for 4 hours, I started watching the video.
Yeah.
And I said, this is going to take me a bit. So
I was just thinking we could, because that one definitely was longer, but the Aprils and the Mays were pretty quick. Oh.
I can definitely look at them quickly for next meeting, or if you guys want to meet in between, I'll have time to read them. But I really didn't have a lot of time over this weekend. I think somebody asked for the draft minutes, they can be sent out if it's been over 3 months or something. But design review did 5 years of minutes in one meeting. 1 year. I wasn't on design review then.
That's a record.
Right? So I hate to, I don't know, I would like to read them if you guys don't mind.
No,
it's fine.
All right. Does anyone have anything else for tonight?
I do not.
Okay. Do you have a motion to adjourn?
Second. I make a motion.
Okay. The motion's been seconded. I'll have a roll call vote. Anthony Zeighton.
Aye.
Bill Pierce.
Aye.
Billy Milton.
Aye.
And I'm an aye. I'll see you guys in September.
Bye. Thank you.
Okay. Good night. Job, Amy. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.